Today we are going to learn about multicollinearity. After this module, you shall be able to understand what happens to regression analysis when multicollinearity is present in the regression model. We would also understand what multicollinearity is, what is its consequences on regression estimates, and also learn about tests for detecting the presence of multicollinearity. In the end, we would try to find out the solution, which means the remedies for carrying out regression analysis in the presence of multicollinearity. Let us introduce the subject. Suppose a researcher is trying to explain the consumption expenditure in a group of individuals and uses both the current income, which could be denoted by X1, and accumulated wealth, could be denoted by X2, of these individuals as explanatory variables. It is possible that while running a regression analysis, the regression coefficient for income, which is denoted by Y, may turn out to be negative, or t-test for the regression coefficients of income and wealth might suggest that none of the two predictors are significantly associated with consumption expenditure, while the f-test indicates that the model is useful for predicting consumption expenditure. Or, for instance, in a model that is built for analyzing wage differentials between male and female workers, if dummy variables for both males and females are included in the regression analysis, the computer software may not be able to estimate the regression coefficients, or it may give you the coefficient of only one of the variables, either male or females. Now, these types of problems arise due to presence of multicollinearity. So the question is, what is multicollinearity? Let us understand this. Multicollinearity is a statistical phenomena and is said to be present when an independent variable is a linear combination of some or all of the other independent variables, and that is a linear combination. So this may be possible. We can have different examples. So an example of multicollinear variables could be GDP, money supply, and prices. Another example could be body mass index and heights of children in a given age group. Let us see what is exact multicollinearity. If two or more explanatory variables have an exact linear relationship between them, then exact or perfect multicollinearity is said to be present. For a k-variable regression model involving x1, x2 to xk regressors, where x1 is equal to 1 to allow for the intercept term, then an exact linear relationship is said to exist if the following condition is satisfied. That is, we can denote this as our first equation. The example above pertaining to dummy variable suffers from exact multicollinearity. If M1 is the dummy variable for males such that M1 is equal to 1 when the worker is male and MI is equal to 0 when the worker is female, similarly, if we denote FI as the dummy variable for females such that FI is equal to 1 when the worker is female and FI is equal to 0 when the worker is male, obviously, so estimating a regression model that contains both the dummy variables MI and FI as explanatory variables will run into the problem of exact multicollinearity. Now, corresponding to this exact multicollinearity, we also have the concept of near multicollinearity. Let us analyze and understand this near multicollinearity. So when the linear relationships among explanatory variables are approximate, the near multicollinearity is said to be present in the model. Now, this can be represented as this is our equation 2, which is a transformed equation from 1. Now, here in this equation 2, Vi is a stochastic error term. Now, the example on consumption function model suffers from near multicollinearity, where current, income, and wealth measure similar attributes about individuals' ability to undertake consumption expenditure. So, in exact multicollinearity, we have an exact linear relationship, whereas in near multicollinearity, we have introduced a stochastic error term, and therefore it is near multicollinearity. So, multicollinearity is nothing but the violation of the assumptions of the classical linear regression model. Let us elaborate on this. One of the assumptions of a classical linear regression model is that there are no exact linear relationships between two or more explanatory variables, and that the number of observations is at least as many as the number of independent variables. That is, we define as n greater than or equal to k. Presence of multicollinearity leads to a violation of this assumption and has consequences related to uniqueness, statistical significance, and precision of the OLS estimators. The presence of perfect multicollinearity makes it impossible to compute the OLS estimates of the regression model. Therefore, the presence of multicollinearity is a problem in regression analysis because any particular regression coefficient measures the partial effect of that particular variable on the dependent variable, holding all other independent variables at a given level. However, when two independent variables vary together, then it is not possible to isolate the partial effect of a single independent variable on the dependent variable ceteris paribus. Note that multicollinearity does not depend on any theoretical linear relationship between the explanatory variables. It depends on the presence of linear relationship between the regressors in the data set. So multicollinearity is a sample phenomena, not the population phenomena. There may be several reasons for the presence of multicollinearity in the data set. For example, the explanatory variables may all have a common underlying time trend, or one of the regressors may be a lagged value of another regressor, or the data may not have been collected from a wide base so that the independent variables may tend to vary together. Let us see the consequences of multicollinearity. So we would try to understand what happens if there is multicollinearity. We would divide this discussion into two parts. First, let us see the consequences of exact multicollinearity. When two or more regressors in a regression model are exactly linearly related, then the regression coefficients cannot be estimated. So suppose we have a following hypothetical data. From their mean values respectively. Now, if there is an exact multicollinearity, then we would assume that x3i is equal to a linear combination of x2i. So suppose x3i is equal to 2x2i, we can easily see that the values of beta 2 hat would come out to be 0 upon 0, which is indeterminate. So on substitution of the values of x2i or x3i equal to 2x2i, you would find that we are not able to find out the coefficient of beta 2 hat. Similarly, let us try to understand the consequence of near multicollinearity. When multicollinearity is not perfect, the model can be estimated with some consequences. First is effect on the properties of estimators. The OLS estimators are blue even in the presence of multicollinearity, which means they are still unbiased, consistent, and efficient. The OLS estimators and their standard errors can be sensitive to small changes in data, making them less precise. At times, the signs of the regression coefficients may be counterintuitive due to the presence of multicollinearity. The t ratios of one or more coefficients may be statistically insignificant, but r square of the model still could be very high. So these are some of the consequences of the presence of multicollinearity. Let us understand the effect on standard errors of regression coefficients. The numerical values of the standard error of the regression coefficients get amplified, making the values of t ratios of one or more coefficients small and thus possibly making them statistically insignificant. Though the hypothesis tests are still valid, the standard error of the regression coefficients beta i's can be given as in equation below. Similarly, we can define R23 square as the coefficient of correlation between X2 and X3. EI is the estimator of mu I and N is the number of observations in our model. K is the number of regressors excluding the intercept, which takes a value 2 in this case. So when X2 and X3 are uncorrelated, R23 square is equal to 0. But when multicollinearity is present, R23 square becomes high, and as a result, the variance of regression parameter as given in equation 4 becomes very high. So what are the consequences? Consequently, the t ratios of the coefficient becomes small and confidence interval becomes large, tending to make the coefficient statistically insignificant and less precise. Thus, the regression coefficients and their standard errors can be very sensitive to small changes in data in the presence of multicollinearity. So, since the OLS estimates are unbiased and consistent, the forecasts based on them are unbiased and confidence intervals are also valid. Let us look at the effect on covariance between regression coefficients, which is our section 4.2.3. The covariance between the regression coefficients will be very high in the presence of multicollinearity. In the regression model given by equation 3, this is our equation 5, where x2i and x3i are defined as before, which are the deviations. R23 is the sample correlation coefficient between x2 and x3, and sigma square is the variance of the error term. So when multicollinearity is present, R23 takes on a value closer to 1, especially if it is high. As a result, the numerical value of the covariance between the estimated regression coefficients becomes very large. Consequently, the interpretation of regression coefficients becomes quite difficult because beta 2 hat, the regression coefficient of x2, is supposed to measure the change in the dependent variable y due to a change in x2 controlling for other variables. However, since x2 and x3 are correlated, any change in x2 is also likely to bring a change in x3, and so beta 2 hat will not only capture the change in y due to x2, but it will also contain some effect of change in x3. This implies that if one estimated parameter beta 2 hat overestimates the true parameter beta 2, then the other estimated parameter beta 3 hat is likely to underestimate the true parameter beta 3 hat, and vice versa. As a result, it becomes difficult to interpret the partial effect of individual regressors on the dependent variable. This at times makes model selection difficult. Let us now look at the effect on hypothesis testing in this section 4.2.5. The tests of hypothesis are still valid, but since the t ratios of the regression coefficients are small, the confidence intervals tend to be much wider, making the test less powerful. There is a greater chance of the regression coefficient being statistically insignificant, although the F statistics may still be significant. So the question is, how do we know whether there is a multicollinearity present in the model? So try to understand the detection of multicollinearity in this section 5. Multicollinearity is a sample phenomena and not a problem with the model. So there are some informal tests rather than formal tests for detecting multicollinearity. The high value of covariance between estimated regression coefficients. If a pair of regressors xk and xj are correlated with each other, the covariance between the estimated regression coefficients as given in equation 5 is going to be high. The second test is the high value of R square and few significant values of T statistics. So when we run the OLS regression, if multicollinearity is present, the results would throw up individual regression coefficients as statistically insignificant, although the value of R square would be very high and the Wald F statistics for joint significance of regression coefficients would also be highly significant. The third test is the high values of correlation coefficients. In the presence of multicollinearity, the pairwise correlation coefficients between the regressors is high. So though while carrying out empirical exercises, it should be kept in mind that in models involving only two independent variables, value of pairwise correlation coefficients are sufficient to test for multicollinearity, but in models involving more than two regressors, this is not a very satisfactory test of multicollinearity because the explanatory variables can be redefined in the number of ways and we may get drastically different measures of correlation. Another very important test is given in this section 5.4, which is auxiliary regression. If multicollinearity is suspected, then in order to find out which of the regressors are linearly related, one may run auxiliary regression and perform F tests. There are certain steps involved in the auxiliary regression. The first step is regress each independent variable on the rest of the independent variables. The step two is compute the corresponding multiple coefficient of determination called Ri square or Rj square, whatever way you wish to define. The third step is perform the following F test to check for collinearity between variables. R square x1 dot x2 xk is the coefficient of determination in the regression of variable x1 on the remaining x variables. The degrees of freedom of this F statistics are k minus 2 and n minus k plus 1, where n is the number of observations and k is the number of explanatory variables, including the intercept. The next step, step 4, is if the computed value of x exceeds the critical value of f at the selected level of significance, then it indicates that the xk or x1 in this example is collinear with other xi's. We also have a Klein rule of thumb, which says that instead of carrying out the above mentioned f test, one can use the Klein's rules of thumb, according to which if the ri square from the auxiliary regression is greater than the overall r square, which is from the dependent variable and independent variables, then multicollinearity is a serious problem. We also have another test, which is known as variance inflation factor, or VIF. So VIF is defined below and can be used as an indicator of the degree of multicollinearity. Where Ri square is the coefficient of determination in the regression model. The larger the value of VIF, the greater the degree of multicollinearity. As a rule of thumb, if VIF of a variable exceeds 10, it is said to be highly collinear with the other variables. We can also define tolerance, and this tolerance is defined as the inverse of VIS. So I'm sure you can understand that if r is square between 2 and 3, which is denoted as r 2 3 square, is equal to 1, which means there is a perfect multicollinearity between x2 and x3 explanatory variables, the tolerance would be equal to 0. And when there is no collinearity, tolerance or TOL takes a value equal to 1. So having understood all these tests or detection of multicollinearity, the question which naturally comes to all of us is that what is the solution or what is the remedy for multicollinearity? So in this section 6, we would try to understand some of the remedies for multicollinearity. It is a matter of judgment by the researcher whether to treat the presence of multicollinearity as a serious problem or as a benign problem. The problem of multicollinearity can be tackled, however, in the following ways. The first, which is advocated, is just ignore the problem. So if an analyst is less interested in interpreting individual coefficients and wants to forecast the value of the dependent variable, then the problem of multicollinearity may be ignored. It is also worthwhile to ignore the problem if the regression coefficients are significant and have meaningful size and magnitude. Multicollinearity may also be ignored if r square from the regression exceeds any of the ri squares. The second remedy which is advocated is that drop the variables which are multicollinear. So multicollinearity may be eliminated by dropping one of the collinearly related variables from the model. But it should be kept in mind that this involves some risk of underspecifying the model if the variable truly belongs to the model. Therefore, one has to be careful in dropping a variable. The third possible solution is obtain extraneous data, which means information from other sources about the variables or values of some of the regression coefficients from some related studies may be incorporated in the model. Also, an important solution is increase the sample size. Now, since we have said multicollinearity is essentially a sample phenomena, using additional data can often solve the problem. Another solution is transform the variables. The variables may be transformed. What is the meaning of transformation of variables? So if the data is a time series data, then one may reformulate the model in terms of the first difference forms. So instead of running the regression model as stated in equation 9.3 or equation 3, the regression that may be estimated is we also have a solution in another technique, which is known as principal component analysis. Principal component analysis, or PCA, is a method by which a number of collinear variables can be transformed into a set of uncorrelated or orthogonal variables called principal components, PCs. These PCs are artificial variables that are constructed in a manner such that they account for most of the variance that is caused in the observed set of correlated variables due to the unobserved common factors between them. In fact, this common factor is what is called a principal component, and there are as many principal components as the number of common factors. Once the PCs have been extracted, the regression may be run on these orthogonal variables in place of the original collinear variables. The characteristic of these PCs is that the first component that is extracted accounts for a maximum amount of total variance in the observed variables. Similarly, the remaining components that are extracted in the analysis account for a maximal amount of variance in the observed variables that was not accounted for by the preceding components and is uncorrelated with all the preceding components. It may be pointed out that in order to extract the PCs, the observed variables are standardized to have a mean of 0 and a variance of 1, and therefore the total variance in the data set, which is simply the sum of the variances of these observed variables, will always be equal to the number of observed variables. This total variance is partitioned among the principal components that are extracted. However, one drawback of the PCA analysis is that generally it is not possible to interpret these principal components in a meaningful way. So, in order to interpret the regression coefficients in a meaningful way, the regression coefficient of the PCs are transformed back into the regression coefficients of original variables that after running the regression. Let us now try to summarize what we have learned in this module today. Multicollinearity is a statistical phenomena and is present when an independent variable is a collinear combination of some or all of the other independent variables in the model. Similarly, we have learned that if two or more explanatory variables have an exact linear relationship between them, then exact or perfect multicollinearity is said to be present. But when the linear relationship of explanatory variables are approximate, then linear multicollinearity is said to be present in the model. We have seen that how the presence of multicollinearity is a problem in regression analysis, because any particular regression coefficient measures the partial effect of that particular variable on the dependent variable, holding all other independent variables at a given level. However, when two independent variables vary together, then it is not possible to isolate the partial effect of a single independent variable on the dependent variable ceteris paribus. So when two or more regressors in a regression model are exactly linearly related, then the regression coefficients cannot be estimated. In case of near multicollinearity, the numerical values of the standard errors of the regression coefficients get amplified, making the values of t ratios of one or more coefficients small, and thus possibly making them statistically insignificant. Multicollinearity is a sample phenomena and not a problem with the model. So there are some informal tests rather than formal tests for detecting multicollinearity. We have seen that the problem of multicollinearity can be tackled in the following ways, such as ignore multicollinearity, drop the variable, obtain extraneous data, increase sample size, transform the variables, and also the principal component analysis. Thank you.